Hello viewers, I am Pratik Bhatt from Bharat Serums and Vaccines, and on behalf of Bharat Serums and Vaccines, I welcome you all to the 29th episode of ART Masterclass Season 1. Today we have with us Dr. Anshu Jindal. Talking about Dr. Anshu Jindal, she has done her MBBS MD from New Delhi, DNB, MNAMS, FICOG. She has been awarded a gold medal for overall best performance in MD from Delhi University in 1995. She is currently the clinical director and IVF specialist at Jindal Hospital, Meerut. She is a joint secretary of UP ESAR, and she is very actively involved as a member of infertility committee of FOCSI. She runs a FOCSI accredited center of excellence for both laparoscopic and infertility training. She has won numerous special awards and achievements. To name a few, she has delivered more than 11,000 children by various techniques of infertility, bringing smiles on a lot of infertile couples. She has appeared on the front page of Times of India for her pioneering work on firstly delivering this. Firstly, delivering the second trimester of the world, whose child is the only surviving progeny in the world for a woman over 7 feet in 2007. She is a regular columnist with Dainik Jagran, a leading daily in the newspaper since 2006. She has had numerous publications to her name. She is invited as a faculty at both national and international conference. She has authored 8 chapters in textbooks of infertility and is highly decorated by various social organizations, including Meerut Ratan in 2008, Green Earth Award, HT Woman of the Year Award. She's actively involved in imparting sex education programs in schools in and around Delhi NCR. With this, I now hand over the session to Dr. Anshu. I request the audience to use the chat box for any questions that you have during the session so that we can take the questions after the session is over. So Dr. Anshu Jindal will be talking about optimizing ovum pickup. She'll be sharing 10 secrets of her about optimizing ovum pickup in an IVF setup. Over to you, Dr. Anshu.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you for inviting me for this lovely session. And I hope that you people will benefit from this session. Amit? So I'm going to share my 10 secrets of a good ovum pickup. And we all know that almost 48.5 million couples worldwide are affected by infertility, such a huge problem. And ultrasound plays a very important role in our daily infertility practice. Transvaginal ultrasound is important both from diagnostic point of view and therapeutic point of view. And one of the most important techniques in IVF is ovum pickup, which is done transvaginally by aspirating the follicle, the oocytes, transvaginally. So this is a very important step. The success of an IVF depends on this step, because the success of an IVF cycle depends on the number of M2 oocytes you have aspirated during a perfect ovum pickup. So I'm going to share with you some of my secrets of doing a good ovum pickup. Let's just talk about the history of oocyte retrieval. We all know that the initial oocytes were actually removed laparoscopically by Professor Edwards and Steptoe in 1970, when the first IVF baby was born. And it was a very tedious and a laborious process because they had to do it laparoscopically. Then in 1980, the commercial OPU needle and pump became available. And that is when the oocyte pickup became so much simpler. And in 1983, Gayasher was the one who introduced transvaginal ovum pickup, about which I'm going to talk about today. So the advantages of transvaginal oocyte pickup is that you can visualize the ovary so well, minimal discomfort to the patient, there is no scar on the abdomen, because it's all done transvaginally with a very sharp needle. So, you know, there's hardly any discomfort that the patient feels. It's done under short GA with IV sedation. There's decreased risk of intestinal trauma because you're all approaching the pelvic structures from below. It's an easily learnable skill, with the cost is also taken care of, quick recovery for the patient. Transabdominal is done only in some certain circumstances, when the ovaries are inaccessible on transvaginal. And this could happen in patients with previous cesarean sections, where the scar pulls the uterus up or the uterus is pulled up in obese abdomens, that is when you would might require a transabdominal. And it is very interesting to know that even the transabdominal pickup is done by the transvaginal probe done abdominally. Let's discuss some of the ergonomics of oocyte retrieval. We know that while the during this process of collection of the oocyte, they can be damaged because of if you're not very perfect about your pump vacuum pressures, the velocity with which the ovum is aspirated, the needle lumen size, the length of the needle, the follicular pressures, and your technique, how well and how nicely you have done your ovum pickup. So you have to be, all these things have to be in perfect tandem. Then it's very important, then once you put the needle inside, you should maintain the suction pressure both at the time of the entry as well as at the time of the exit. And this is very important, otherwise you can lose that precious follicular fluid with the oocytes. It's also been seen that sometimes the movement of the needle tip in the follicle can actually damage the oocyte, or it can damage the the walls of the oocyte. And it is a very common practice to spin the needle tip both clockwise and anti-clockwise in order to complete your aspiration process, and which is also called the curetting the follicle. And actually, it helps in improving the yield of the oocytes. Some people scrape the follicle wall by the edging of the needle, and this is actually not a good practice. This should be discouraged because it can cause significant damage to the oocytes, especially the small oocytes, which are actually difficult to pick up. We all know that an oocyte pickup is done after 34 to 36 hours after the HCG trigger, and to get the best M2 oocytes, which are the mature oocytes. And either the trigger can be HCG or it can be agonist trigger. That depends on the patient profile. It is very important to assess the ovarian accessibility and should be assessed prior to ovum pickup. And this is usually done when the patient comes to you, or in the minus one cycle, when you have fully worked up the patient for IVF, it is that time in a minus one cycle or the dummy cycle, you can look for ovarian accessibility. You can even do it during the stimulation. That is also a very good point to see, to notice. And very high and unapproachable ovaries actually pose difficulty for TVS. And as we said, then these patients, they might require a transabdominal. And very rarely do you require a translaparoscopy. You need a laparoscopy for doing your ovum pickups. The anesthesia is usually done under mild general anesthesia, propofol or pentothal, and it can be done under IV sedation as well. And in some centers in Scandinavia, they do a cervical or a vaginal, they do a cervical block and do an ovum pickup. It is possible, but I think from patient's point of view, it is a good idea to give them IV sedation and give them a short general anesthesia. Pre-anesthetic checkup is advisable. And any history of blood thinners, aspirin, coagulation defects in the patient, if the patient has any family history, should be elicited. And any blood pressure medication, thyroid medication, any special medication that the patient is on, she has to take it pre-op. That you have to keep it in mind. Now let's come to the material checklist for an OPU theater. It consists of the dry blocks, heaters or the heat sinks, and BD tubes or beakers, petri dishes, suction pump. I'm going to show you a video after some time as to the equipment in an OPU theater. So this is just to complete the list: needle, tubing, and an ultrasound machine with the transvaginal probe. That is a very important thing. As you can see here, all this equipment, you can see the transvaginal probe with the needle guide, you can see the Lavotec suction apparatus, and you can see the heat sinks here in the background. Temperature control is very important because we all know that these oocytes are very sensitive to temperature and they can be damaged by any changes in the temperature. It should be maintained at body temperature, which is maintained with the help of this heat sink, like you can see here, which is maintained at 37 degrees, which is the body temperature. Handheld test tube warmers are no longer used, and it is a very good idea to have an integrated table which has a heated laminar table, so that once on the IVF table also, you have a good temperature control. The aspiration needle, you can see, this is a short video of the aspiration needle. You can see it's a 17 gauge needle with edgings at the tip, and the edgings are made to make the visualization of the needle on the screen better. It is either single lumen or double lumen. I usually go for the single lumen because you can get very excellent results with even the single lumen. Double lumen may be used only in follicles, in IVMs, in small follicles, or if the follicle number is very low. And connecting tube should be transparent, ideally transparent, or at least translucent, so that whatever you are aspirating into your tube, you can visualize it and you can see the contents, whether it's blood stained or not. A perfect hand-eye and foot coordination is a must during an ovum pickup. You can see we are loading our transvaginal probe with the needle guide, and we are just seeing the, we're positioning the needle inside. This goes inside the needle goes inside like this, and now once it comes out of this it means that it is in an advanced position, it is ready, and this is how it appears on a vaginal ultrasound screen. This is a very old video of mine, and you can see the needle, you can see the echo tip needle, and you can see a patient with quite a few follicles, almost with a polycystic look, and how the needle should be visualized at all time during the ovum pickup. You should be able to see the tip of the needle whenever you are doing an ovum pickup. And this is the uterus, this is the endometrial lining. You can see the ovary is almost stuck up to the side of the uterus. So a perfect hand-eye coordination is required for a good ovum pickup. And now let me give you my 10 secrets. My first secret is that you should bring the patient to the edge of the table for easy maneuverability of the TVS probe, because it's very important that the movement of your probe should be easy. Sometimes in obese patients in a lithotomy position, you might realize that the thighs get in your way and you have to adjust the patient in a lithotomy position with her thighs abducted. Do a pre-scan to visualize the ovarian accessibility, to look for any endometriomas or any other major vessel in the way. So a pre-scan is very important to look for both the ovaries as well as the uterus and the endometrium, and to scan for any untoward pelvic structure that might hinder your actually the ovum pickup. The ultrasound machine, the patient and the operator should be in the same line. So when you're operating on the left ovary, you have to shift, because the left ovary will be visualized on the right side of your screen. So you have to shift your stool or where, on the position in which you're sitting, to the right side. And when you're operating on the right ovary, you have to shift your stool on the left side. So this is very important that you make a few changes while you're doing your ovum pickup, so that the visualization is perfect and the ultrasound machine, the patient and the operator should be in the same line. Invert the image. You can see here, I have done this on my screen, one of my latest videos, which also shows that I've inverted the screen. And this actually helps you in ovum pickup, because you are operating from below upwards in a when you're doing a transvaginal scan. And similar picture is reproduced on your screen. So it is much better that you invert your ultrasound image as you're approaching the ovaries from below. The fourth secret is very important. You should place the transvaginal probe as close to the ovary as possible, which means that there should be no structure in between your transvaginal probe and the ovary that you have to visualize and then do the pickup. An adherent ovary can usually pose a big problem in such patients, especially in patients with endometriosis or where there's a hydrosalpinx. And in these patients or in obese patients, then you have to help, you have to have an assistant on your left or the right side. Usually I keep my assistant on the left side who will help me by simple maneuvering manipulations per abdomen and bring the ovary down. So this is, and you can even tilt your table. So this is a very important step because you should not be running behind the follicle. You should bring the follicle under view and then do your ovum pickup. My fifth secret is that the vaginal needle through the fornicus should be kept between 10 o'clock and 2 o'clock. And why is this important? Which means you should be you're doing your vaginal punctures between 10 o'clock and 2 o'clock. And why is this very important? Because it's very important because the descending cervical and the vaginal vessels are usually placed at 3 o'clock and 9 o'clock position. So you are safely away from these vessels because actually it is these vessels which bleed during an ovum pickup and, you know, cause so much of delay and so much of anxiety to the surgeon. So these, you should avoid these at 3 o'clock and 9 o'clock position. So this is a very important fifth secret. Then it is that strike the follicle with a jab or a stab because you have to manipulate, please don't disturb. And because you have to, you have to really hit the follicle with a stab. Otherwise, you are going to miss it because you have to penetrate the follicular wall. So you just strike it. And these edgings on the needle, actually, they help you a lot because they give you a very good view on the ultrasound machine. And while you're traversing the needle, the ultrasound probe which has the needle, you don't stop, avoid contaminating the needle tip by keeping it inside the needle guide until ready to pierce the vagina. Which means, and your suction should also be off. Once you're traversing the needle guide, please keep your suction off. It's only when you are going to penetrate the follicle, which means you've touched the ovarian surface, it is then that your suction should be on. Flush the needle in between the two ovaries because sometimes the needle can get blocked. And if you enter the follicle with a blocked needle, it's a real problem. Then you keep doing your suction, there's nothing coming out. Then you take out the needle, you have to flush it. So always the needle should be flushed. Your suction pump should be running well. And you should be aware that the suction machine is working well and the needle is nicely flushed before you do the next pickup. The needle should strike the follicle at 90 degrees to the follicle at the most dependent part, which means if there's a follicle here, you should make the follicle as round as possible. Bring the follicle under view. Do not run behind a follicle. Bring the follicle closer by doing some manipulations of the ultrasound probe as well as some abdominal manipulations if the ovary needs to be steadied. And then you should hit the follicle at 90 degrees to the follicle at the most dependent part, keeping the follicle as round as possible on your transvaginal screen. Vacuum should be activated when you enter the follicle and also when you're exiting the follicle. And needle tip should also be always visible on the screen. And the needle tip should preferably be kept in the center of the follicle when you're aspirating the follicle. Try to keep the needle tip, like you can see, this is a follicle, this is of a varied shape because of polycystic, she has so many follicles. And this follicle is literally, it's not that regular in shape. But while I'm doing my oocyte aspiration, always try to keep the needle in the center of the follicle. As the follicle collapses, you have to maneuver it and bring it to the center all the time. And when the follicle aspiration is completed, then you withdraw the needle again with the suction on. Otherwise, the follicle might be trapped inside or get adhered to the follicular wall. And it is a good practice to actually puncture all the follicles, because you decrease the chances of OHSS if you aspirate all the follicles. So it is very important that you should not leave behind follicles. Though I know in the beginning of your practice, it might be difficult for you to do all the follicle oocyte pickup. But as you become an expert in the procedure, you will realize that actually you are able to pick up most of them, almost 80 to 90% of these follicles. This is the ninth commandment, is very important. Once the needle is in an advanced state, but which means that it is inside the ovary and the follicle, please do not move the TVS probe to scan the ovaries or to move the TVS probe, because your needle inside the follicle is also going to have a similar movement and it can tear the ovarian tissue, causing bleeding. This is especially important in patients of ovarian hyperstimulation, because you realize that the ovaries in such patients are very soft. The follicle walls are also very delicate. So any kind of maneuverability like this can actually, of the transvaginal probe, can actually damage the ovarian cortex, leading to bleeding and a hematoma formation. In fact, in the beginning of our practice, when I started doing OPU, unfortunately, while we were doing a ovum pickup in a patient, the patient suddenly, because of some anesthetic problem, moved up. Suddenly, and the needle with which I was doing the ovum pickup, which was in the active state, an advanced state, it really went through the ovarian cortex, and we brought the patient down, but the patient had bleeding from the ovarian cortex, and we had to do a laparotomy for that patient. 6 hours later, we were able to save her, but it was a very, very harrowing complication of an OPU. Thankfully, this was very much in the beginning. We've never had that complications ever. So it's very important to do a pelvic scan at the end of the procedure to know of any intraperitoneal bleeding, anything untoward that might you have caused after an OPU. Especially intraperitoneal bleeding, it will appear as a hyperechoic or as a fluid collection. You can see it. You can see fluid in the pouch of Douglas. And you should keep tabs on it. A small amount of bleeding is okay, but anything more than 100 ml is to be taken very seriously. My 10th secret is tap as many follicles as possible present in the same line from below upwards before moving the plane or the focus of your ultrasound. And it is always a good practice to go from proximal to distal and from lateral to medial, which means you should tap the follicles below the lower ones and then go on to the upper ones, and tap the follicles on the lateral borders, then go on to the medium. Sometimes these follicles, which are low down in your pickup, which are nearer to the probe, actually are more difficult to pick up. And the smaller follicles, less than 12 or 13 millimeters, those are the ones which are difficult to pick up. And avoid repeated vaginal punctures. You should make sure that through one vaginal puncture, you pick up as many follicles as you can. So, flushing is very debatable. I usually do not use a double lumen tube, or I use a single lumen tube, and flushing with a double lumen is actually feasible only in patients who are poor responders, in patients for IVM and small follicles, or who are very poor responders. And if there are more than 10 follicles seen on the on your screen or on both the ovaries, then actually there is no role for flushing. It can only, in fact, prolong the procedure, cause discomfort to the patient. And it is always better to complete the follicle completely, because you can miss the oocyte complexes if you do not aspirate completely. And secondly, to decrease the chance of OHSS, it is always better to tap the follicle completely, and as many follicles, especially the small follicles, should be tapped. Now, I'll come to some video presentations which I made of some very interesting OPU cases which I've recorded recently, and it shows a video presentation. Can I have it on? The video presentation of difficult cases as well as in difficult situations.
Welcome to the OPU Theatre. I'll just demonstrate to you the OPU Theatre today and all the equipment that we have in the OPU setup. So this is the OPU needle. You can see it's a 17 gauge needle with edgings, and these edgings provide a very nice view on ultrasound. You can see a very echogenic tip of so all along when you're doing an OPU, you should see the tip of the needle should always be in view. And this is then connected by a transparent tubing to the BD tubes, and the other end is connected to the suction machine, the suction Labatec aspirator 3 we have, and this generates a pressure of around 100 millimeters of mercury. You should keep it the setting around 100 to 130 and not more than that. And once I press the foot pedal, you can see this pressure starts increasing, and when you're entering the ovum, the suction machine should be on. This is our anesthesia trolley, which, because a short anesthesia is required for these procedures, you can see the microscope in the background. This is what we use for TESA, micro TESA. And now the most important part, the ultrasound machine, the transvaginal with the transvaginal probe, and this you can see in this. I have set it in the inversion mode so that you can see in an inverted image. This helps in OPU, and this is a TVS probe along with a guide, and this is how your needle, the OPU needle, is going to enter. So this is the basic setup for an OPU theater.
Now you can see, this is the first video is of a patient. This is a pre-scan video, pre-ovum pickup scan. This is, as I told you, is very important. You can see here the ovaries, the blood vessels in the background, the pelvic vessels. And this is very important. This is an OPU in a normal responder. In a patient who responded normally, which means between 5 to 15 number of oocytes in both the ovaries. You can see the number of follicles here. The size of the follicle is also variable. In fact, in this follicle, you can even see the cumulus. This is the cumulus. This is the COC, the cumulus oocyte complex. So try to hit the follicle at the most dependent part, and at 90 degrees to the follicle. And as you are aspirating, see, this has been successful in the first attempt, so I'm going to try again. And this is here it goes. You can see some turbulence while you're doing the suction. And as the follicle collapses, you can see how I'm withdrawing the needle so that I'm in the center of the follicle all along. And the oocyte can be aspirated. It doesn't get stuck up between the two walls. So this is a very important step. A little, you have to be really persistent. See, the third go only I could do the pickup. This is a very early video of mine. And in fact, my ultrasound machine has also changed ever since. Now this was, this is an OPU in a high responder, in a patient who has a polycystic look. You can see the number of follicles here. And can you visualize that these the follicular wall in patients who have hyper-responded actually are very thin. So while you're doing a pickup, you can realize that it's all very, you know, very smooth. The pickup is actually very smooth, but you have to be very gentle with these ovaries, because these ovaries are a little softer than the normal ovaries. So you can see that they are also closely placed, and through one puncture I'm going to aspirate as many, then I withdraw the needle, then I bring another follicle under focus, and then again I enter from below. Trying to keep the needle tip in the center of the follicle. Now another follicle comes into focus. So what I was trying to tell you is that you try to bring the follicle closer to the needle rather than the needle running behind the follicle, because in that way you don't injure the ovarian cortex and you get a very good oocyte yield. Your embryologist will tell you, as you're sending the oocyte, follicular fluid to your embryologist, just keep checking with them how many oocytes you have picked up, for how many follicles you punctured and how many did you pick up. If it is more than 80%, then it means you have done a good job. And see this very interestingly, you can see this is how the follicle looks like. It almost starts looking hyperechoic at the end of the pickup. You can see how it started looking hyperechoic. This is the endometrium, the uterus, and you can see the other ovary is so stuck up, and this is going to pose a problem actually in the pickup. I'm back to the previous one. This is the ovary. This is how the ovary looks like at the end of it. You've almost done 3/4 of it. Two, three follicles are still left on the right side. And see, there's no structure in between your probe as well as the needle. You are directly there. This is a patient OPU in a poor responder, and with fewer number of follicles, so your OPU is of a shorter duration, and you can finish the procedure soon, but you have to be very careful. You cannot afford to leave even a single follicle behind, because as it is, the patient has almost 5 to 7 follicles, and the retrieved follicles might be even less than 5. So you have to be very careful, and you need actually more skills in patients with poor responders. Now, these are the patients in which the OPU is very difficult. This is a patient who has multiple fibroids. You can see this uterus. This is one posterior wall intramural fibroid, and the ovary. Can you visualize that the ovary has been stuck up behind the uterus because of all the altered anatomy because of fibroids? You can see these follicles here. This is the cervix. And sometimes you have to approach these follicles through the cervix. You have to puncture the cervix also at times. This is also in a patient in whom she had endometriosis. We prepared her for IVF, and then after that, we took her on a long protocol, and after that, after her endometriosis has settled, this is how we did the ovum pickup in one of our patients with endometriosis. You can see in this video that the size of the follicles is is not synchronous. Usually in polycystic ovarian, you will get one synchronous size, but here you can see some are small, some are big, interspersed with some hemorrhagic cyst. Which is actually a part of endometriosis. So you have to avoid tapping those endometriotic cysts while you're doing your OPU. And you can see some sizes, they're all variable sizes here. And these ovum pickups in patients with endometriosis is actually, it's quite difficult, not so simple. You can see that I have the nice needle tip all along when I'm doing the pickup, especially for this small one also. The needle tip is visualized all along. And these are smaller ones which are actually more difficult to pick up. This is another old video of a patient, obese PCOS patient, and you can see the ovaries almost covering the entire screen. She's an obese PCOS. You can see the number of follicles. There are so many follicles she has right up to the end, and my needle has to traverse the whole cortex of the ovary to reach this follicle on the top. So you start from the proximal end, you go on to the distal end, and you start, it's not a rule, but you start on the lateral end and then you go on to the middle end. You can see these are difficult pickups when the whole ovary is traversing, has to traverse the ovarian cortex to reach those follicles high above, which are so placed so high. And in the meantime, you have to make sure that you are away from the pelvic vasculature, the iliac vessels. So these are difficult pickups. These are extremely difficult pickups. You can appreciate the echogenic cortex of polycystic ovarian. This, you can see the cortex, you can see the peripherally lined follicles, and you can see how the needle is being negotiated to this. And this is how the follicular fluid, after you have collected the follicular fluid, you hand it over to the embryologist, who will just going to see the scan the follicular fluid for COCs. And you can see this is a very important job of an embryologist. They're going to pip it out the COCs from this follicular fluid. This is how they appear. This is how they appear on naked eye appearance. They'll be put in the outer well of a round petri dish. And now finally gathering the oocytes in the center well, from the outer well onto the center well. I included this video to show how these cumulus oocyte complexes look like on appearance, and how they will, the embryologist will start doing his work after you have done your bit of oocyte pickup. Yeah.
Welcome to the OPU Theater. I'll just demonstrate.
Stop. Then we come back to the presentation. So I get back to my presentation. We'll do some troubleshooting in OPU. No, it's not like this. Not the videos. I'll just get back. Wait. The video's off. Done. Ye to. Okay. So what do you do when you don't visualize the needle tip on your ovum pickup? The best is to withdraw the needle and insert it again, and every time you insert it again, make sure that it is under your full visualization. If the ovary is high up, which as I showed you in the videos, it can be difficult in patients who are polycystic, obese, or where they have undergone multiple pelvic surgeries, so the uterus gets pulled up, then you need an assistant who will stabilize it, will bring the ovary down for you. You can tilt the table and bring the ovary down with some manipulations. So that is very important. What do you do if the suction fails? So you can rotate the needle within the follicle to ensure that the tip is not blocked by the follicular wall. And sometimes this really works. If it is blocked, you have to withdraw it and you have to do a retrograde flush. Check the patency of the needle by aspirating some culture media before you insert it again in your needle guide. What you do when you have empty follicle syndrome, that is when you don't find any oocyte complexes in the follicular fluid that you've aspirated. First of all, check the timing, dose, and the type of trigger, and who has given the trigger. That is also very important. Where has the patient taken it? And because sometimes we've seen that, you know, if you rely and let the patient take the trigger at some far away place, so they sometimes do a mistake in that, and the trigger might not have been given or might have been given inadequately. If it's an HCG, if you have given an HCG trigger, what you do is you can, on the follicular fluid, you can check for the by the pregnancy test or by doing the serum beta HCG levels in the follicular fluid. If the beta HCG levels are more than 23 million international units per ml, or if the pregnancy test is positive, this means that the trigger has been correct. It has been correctly given. In case of an agonist trigger, you can check for the LH levels by using the LH search kits or by doing the serum LH levels. And the serum LH levels should be more than 15 international units per ml. And if that is so, this means the trigger has been given. If the tests are negative, then you give a second trigger, full dose, like 10,000 of HCG or recombinant HCG, if that is what you've given, or your agonist trigger, full dose, and you can repeat the OPU after 36 hours. If it is that the ovulation has prematurely happened and you find fluid, what you will see is fluid in the pouch of Douglas. Then it is imperative to aspirate that peritoneal fluid, and you can look for these COCs in the peritoneal fluid. And sometimes you are able to get some COCs in this peritoneal fluid. Difficulties on OPU, we just talked about some in my video. Ovaries stuck up to the fundus, if the follicles are placed too near the major blood vessels, entry into an endometrioma, vaginal wall bleeding, entry to the cervix, or even seeing hydrosalpinx. This is how a scarred abdomen, this is a very, very, this is almost 5 years back, we did an ovum pickup on this patient who had scars like this. This is not so usual, but this is what we found, that the ovary was all stuck up to the fundus, and ovum pickup was quite difficult in such patients. It is very difficult, and this patient, it was actually quite difficult, but we were prepared for it. She was a poor responder. She had only 3-4 oocytes on each side, and we were mentally prepared that this is going to be a challenging task. So we were able to retrieve 5 oocytes in her case as well. Too near the major blood vessels, you can see the iliac. Actually, this is a follicle which I'm tapping, aspirating, and what you can see here looks like a follicle, but it is not. It is not a follicle. Actually, it's the iliac vessels. And you just move the ultrasound probe, and you will realize as you change the plane, the contour of the blood vessel changes. It appears like a river. It starts looking like a river. I always say that I can see the river now. So these are the iliac vessels, not touch them. So this is how, see, this is a follicle, but this is a blood vessel. So you have to keep changing your plane of ultrasound to see whether it's a blood vessel or a follicle. And now with color Doppler machines, most of our ultrasound machines have color Dopplers. We can activate a color Doppler and see whether it's a blood vessel or it's a follicle. That also comes handy. Then endometriomas. This is a laparoscopic image of a patient on whom we did a grade 4 endometriosis. You can see the uterus, the pouch of Douglas is completely obliterated. You can see the endometrioma, and this is how the ultrasound picture looks like. You can see a big, hemorrhagic cyst here. You can see the follicles behind it. So just tap on the follicles which are behind the cyst. Please do not tap on the endometrioma. If inadvertently you do, then what you have to do is that this is contamination of the follicular fluid. just change the whole, the syringe as well as the set. And just you have to change the whole thing so that you don't contaminate the other oocytes that you're going to pick up. And preferably, please do not pierce the endometrioma during your ovum pickup if it's possible. Even dermoids should not be punctured during OPU, since it also increases the risk of PID and peritonitis. And they have found that in patients with endometrioma or teratoma, the risk of PID increases even if they have not been punctured, in this beautiful paper in 2018, that actually should give them an antibiotic cover if you feel that there could be some infection. And as I just said, if it is inadvertently punctured, the needle should be immediately withdrawn, flushed with media, and the collection tube should also be changed. In patients with borderline ovarian tumors, it is unclear whether the ART procedures is associated with an increased risk of recurrence. So all this is actually part of your checkup before you take up these patients. These things should be clarified. Then hydrosalpings, standard management of hydrosalpings, they should be managed before IVF. You take them up for IVF. But if at all, and when a hydrosalping is discovered during an OPU, the best option is to go for oocyte or embryo cryopreservation. The benefit of aspirating on the day of OPU actually needs further studies before it can be, really practiced whether it can be advocated, before it can be advocated. Complications, vaginal bleeding happens in 1.4 to 18% percent of the patients. And this is when usually it is vaginal bleeding. As you can see here, there's a spurter here from the vagina, which is bleeding. And all that you need to do is put pressure over there. Tell your anesthetist to tell you after 3 to 5 minutes and keep pressing it. Only in rare cases that you really need to take a suture to, ligate that vessel. Intraperitoneal bleed, thankfully, a rare complication happens in 1 to 1.3% of the cases. It can be intraperitoneal, which is actually visible, or it can be even retroperitoneal, which is a little dangerous because it will present a little later, almost 10 hours after an OPU. Infections, especially PID, can happen in less than 1% of the cases, and this is because the vaginal flora is carried. If it is infected, it can be carried into the peritoneal cavity once you're doing a needle puncture. And that is why I said, when your needle is in the needle guide, please do not put the suction on, because your suction machine will suck out all that is in the vagina as well. So only when you have entered the ovary that the suction should be on. Infected structures like infected hydrosalpings, oophoritis, endometriomas, if you tap them, then you have to give them a prophylactic broad spectrum antibiotic. Keep tabs on any endotoxemia or acute infections, and give them a good coverage of antibiotics. Call them back again. So this is my last slide. OPU is one of the very important steps in IVF. As we just discussed, actually the success of an IVF is dependent on a good OPU. The competence of an IVF specialist plays a very important role in navigating through this procedure. Adequate training in OPU should include basic training in ultrasound. At least 50 OPUs should be done independently by an IVF specialist before they can, they can be allowed to do it. And proficiency is defined as retrieving more than 80% of all oocytes. An OPU expert is the one who has done at least 250 OPUs in practice. And these are all the ESHRAE guidelines on the ESHRAE pages. I have taken these ESHRAE guidelines. And the future developments would include color Doppler studies to detect any vascular areas, and artificial intelligence, which is now coming in a big way in infertility, will also come here too, based on ultrasound findings, patient profile, biochemical metrics for predicting the follicular growth, especially in poor responders, how well they're going to respond to our stimulation is a way forward. So thank you so much for this very patient hearing, and I hope you enjoyed this lecture, and I would welcome any questions regarding this. Thank you
so much, ma'am, for that elaborate presentation. It was very simplifying of the enigma around ovum pickup. And thank you so much for making such a beautiful slide, which covered all aspects of ovum pickup. So we'll now move on to the questions.
Yeah.
I'll be taking questions which are repeated on a large basis. What kind of pre-op antibiotics do you suggest, and is it routine? Is it safe?
Yes, pre-op antibiotics, we do give one shot of, amoxicillin, and we do give gentamicin to the patient, just single dose before OPU. And this is just as a precaution, but it is not a must. You can skip on if you need not give antibiotics if the patient is absolutely, there are no contraindications like endometriomas and all.
Okay. So Dr. Varsha is asking, how do you manage and what to do if you accidentally prick the internal iliac, bladder or bowel?
Oh, yeah. So that is one thing which has to be avoided. And that is why these five secrets have been told to you. So please avoid pricking any iliac vessels, because that can be catastrophic. So you have to when you do your pre-scan, make sure where your pelvic vessels are. If the anatomy is distorted, you need to be more careful. So iliacs, there is no excuse. You are not supposed to touch them. And as I said, they sometimes look like follicles. Change your plane of ultrasound and just see on a different plane, they will appear like the anatomy will be defined to you even better. They look like rivers, as if a river is flowing by. So you should not touch the iliacs. Bowel, usually they don't pose much problem. If you do, you can get some kind of peritonitis, some kind of localized peritonitis can happen. But this is also because bowel is very mobile. So injuring bowel during a pickup is quite rare, is very rare. And bladder, sometimes I have seen that sometimes you might inadvertently enter the bladder. But since the needle is so thin, I mean, you can just, when you realize it, you just withdraw your needle, try not to enter the bladder. But usually bladder injuries are also not a big problem in OPU.
Dr. Makhija is asking, how do you deal with high up ovaries or if ovaries are stuck behind uterus?
That I just showed you videos of. That is a bit of a problem. First of all, bring the patient to the edge of the table. Ask your assistant to steady the ovaries. Sometimes these ovaries are very mobile, especially in patients who have undergone pelvic surgery. These ovaries are very mobile. So somebody needs to fix them. So you need a good assistant who is familiar with this job of fixing the ovaries. Actually, you just need you put your hand per abdomen and fix the ovaries so that it doesn't move around when when you're entering with an OPU needle. And secondly, then difficult pickups, you have to bring the ovary down. So by little bit of either the tilting the table, you can put them on Trendelenburg, or you can make the head down first. And you can, by lateral tilt also, sometimes you have to give a lateral tilt to the table, see which place it is the best position where you can do you can visualize your ovaries. So a lot of manipulations goes into it, and an assistant is definitely required. And there are situations when there will be some follicles which you will not be able to pick up because you don't want to injure the structure. So it is better, it is wiser to stop there rather than going all out that I have to pick all follicles. Just take it easy, just step back.
Okay. One more question, ma'am. It's very patient specific. Do you want me to ask it?
Yeah.
Okay. So one of the doctors is asking, what difficulties can be kept in mind for an ovum pickup of a 38-year-old patient with right ovary of 4.5 centimeter with recurrent chocolate cyst and left ovary is normal, but is adherent to left posterolateral side of uterus. The AFC on the right side is 9 and left is 4. This is on the day 3 scan.
AFC is 9 millimeter or 9 follicles? I didn't understand that.
I think it's 9. AFC is on the right ovary is 9 and left is 4.
It's 4. See, all these videos that are shared with you and one of the endometriosis, all these patients have a similar situation. The ovaries are adherent. They are stuck up to the bladder. So I have done OPUs when I've entered through the cervix also. You have to sometimes go through the pelvic structures. But it's awareness. You should be aware that when you're traversing the structure, which structure did you traverse through and how quick you were in aspirating those follicles. So it can be a very tricky situation. So all those manipulations, table tilt and all that we have just talked about, that you have to, ask your assistant to fix the ovaries for you. But after all that has been taken care of, usually you might enter through the cervix or even through the endometrium at times. You might be doing that, but it's a very rare case. You are able to pick up some follicles. The problem happens when there's an endometrioma sitting there and there are follicles behind it. That in some cases you might have to do an pick up on that endometrioma in a separate collecting BD tube, change the collecting system, and then you are able to visualize those follicles which are lying behind, and then you have to tap those also. So these are tricky situations, differ from patient to patient, and you have to give them antibiotics. You have to be very careful with all this.
We're getting a lot of questions on how much pressure do you keep while doing an OPU.
I think I forgot to mention that it's 100 millimeters of mercury. You can go up to 130. I would not suggest going above that because then there is chances of injuring the oocytes while you're aspirating. So too much of pressure is not good. Up to 130 is okay.
Okay. A lot of people are talking about elaborating on abdominal ovum pickup. Can you just quickly sum up some factors about abdominal ovum pickup?
Abdominal ovum pickups are done only if the ovaries are inaccessible, as I said, if there have been pelvic surgeries, endometriosis, and the same probe that you use in transvaginal. Actually, you put the same probe, clean the abdomen, put the jelly on the probe as you would do, and through the same needle guide, the same needle which you use for transvaginal OPU, you approach it from the transabdominal end. And actually, I have not done it, but I've just seen people, I've read about it. I've never had the, I'd never found the need to do it, but it's. I believe it is not that difficult.
Okay. We'll take one last question, ma'am. I think this is a very recurrent question that I've been asked. Do you routinely do a second sitting of OM pickup, or do you suggest or advise a routine second sitting of OM pickup if there are 3 or 4 follicles left after the first OM pickup has been done?
Second sitting after how long? I mean, what
3 to 4 days. 3 to 4 days is what is being asked.
No, not at all.
So thank you so much, ma'am, for simplifying your secrets for us and sharing your practice details with the audience, and which is a learning exposure for a lot of us. And with this, madam, I would request you to sum up your session with 3 or 4 key takeaway points which the audience will remember, like in their routine practice forever.
What I would like to say, that this is a very important interventional ultrasound skill, but very learnable. The more you do it, the better you become. And very important to be good in your ultrasounds, especially your transvaginal ultrasound. So if you're doing your transvaginal ultrasound in daily practice, you can be a master at this also. As the RCOG pages says that you should have done at least 50. And to be called an expert, you should do at least 250 of them. That is very important. And what I would like to say is that in simple OPUs are easy. It is more, what is challenging is difficult OPUs in patients with endometriosis and patients with PIDs and hydrosalpinx. So these are the difficult ones which actually you have to master, and you master them over a period of time. So it's a learnable skill, but be mindful when you're doing it. So be present when you're doing an open pickup.
Thank you so much, ma'am. On behalf of Bharat Serums and Vaccines, I express my sincere thanks for taking time out and delivering this session for us. Also, I thank my audience for a very patient listening. With this, we are at the end of the AIT Masterclass Season 1, Episode 29. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you.